I think this should probably be our next victim. Before we bring it over. The tins are all loose. Someone's been in there. We'll bring it over to the pressure washer. And I think we should clean it off. Give us a fighting chance of keeping us kind of clean. Like somebody stole the fuel filter out of it for some reason. And there's another tin that goes over the top of this that's missing. So we'll see what it takes to get all that back together. Mower deck doesn't look rotten. Front tires are a little low. The back look all right. A date on the battery. Don't see one. Date on the tractor. Forget which ones it is. Should be in there somewhere. Let's call it a 2000. We'll just guess. Oh, so hit it with the pressure washer and get her in the garage. They got it in the garage, it's all cleaned up, kind of cleaned up. And again, that guy, that coil looks kind of crappy on the end of it, missing the boot. Two screws are missing out of this tin. I don't know if you guys can see on an angle there, you can see there's a mouse nest of sorts already inside there too. And these screws are removed. Probably gonna throw the battery charger on it, check the oil. And there's not much holding this cover on. We'll get this cover off right away, get that nest out of the way, and then we'll try spinning it from there. Let's get that cover off and see what kind of surprises are hanging in there. So it's three, and I said, there's it's running a metal starter gear. That's good. Your phone wiggling. Let's go with these two. Might be something behind the air cleaner, but let's see if that'll come off. There we go. Oh yeah. It's a new home. Gotta stop kicking you. Nobody presently moved in. A fresh one. We'll blow that out with air and get that cleaned up, and then we'll see what power to the starter and see how she sounds. Alright, so tin's off, blew it off. The trans is in neutral, the brake lever's locked down. I don't know if I need to be sitting on the seat, but let's just see if it'll crank. I think that battery may need to charge a little bit more than that. And the other thing that I saw was the fuel level. Yeah, that's not a mistake. The oil level, AKA fuel level, is up to there. And it smells like gas. So the carburetor flooded over and dumped all the gas into the engine. So that is another problem that's with it now. I guess we can kind of probably move forward to the carb, looking into that, pull the spark plug out, maybe spin it a little bit, and the top of the cylinder might be a little bit hydrolocked. It made a full cycle around, but it might have some fuel inside there, so. Let me get to that. I took the spark plug out of it. Let's see if it blows crap all over the place or not. definitely say it's pissing water on me from washing it out. Let's see if it's got spark. Yeah, it's good. It's got spark. Going for the float pole. Wrong side. Again, this solenoid should have shut that fuel off so it did not do what it did. I think that might be missing a plunger on top. Oh, yeah, there's your problem. I think fuel's going to have a hard time doing anything when it is jello. It's literally jello. That's a good vintage. I think we're going to have to take that carburetor off of there and possibly soak that. What do you think? No? Yes? I go with a yes. But I must say that's a little on the gooey side. Somewhere in there is a pin. Should be a pin. I find this stuff happens from some of the fuel savers. Stuff you put in to save your fuel, and it does that to it, unfortunately. Let's see. I gotta get something to tap that pin out. It's not gonna get pushed out. Everybody's favorite hammer. Oh, but everybody's mine. It's definitely got some goo going on it. So I'm going to fire up the ultrasonic cleaner. But first I'm going to take an air gun and just kind of blow the snot off of this thing. And get it down to something we can get somewhat clean. Should probably pop this guy off too. Get the proper tool. Well, that carb's clean. Why don't we see if we can get the gas oil mix out of it. And the biggest thing I'm hoping for is that the bottom end is still okay on this thing, because sometimes when it happens, they get a little knocky on the bottom side. Yeah, that runs like a five weight. Not exactly trickling like oil now, is it? It'll be clean inside though. Yeah, let's go see how dinner's cooking. We'll shut off the vibrations. And what I ended up going for a mix is I used orange. Nice and clean. I use the orange windshield washer fluid because I'm worried about stuff freezing in the winter and I want to be able to set something up. So it's orange windshield washer fluid and simple green. Simple green is in there for the mix. And we'll see how that holds up and does for cleaning. But looks pretty good. It's looking pretty clean to me. Wasn't able to get the jet out of the center, so I figured I'd try cleaning it and then we'll try getting it out. The screw's starting to rip out. No, it's not focusing. See it tearing out? Now the steam's getting you. Alright, I'll bring you back. So I wasn't able to get the screw out. I was able to get it about 3/4 of the way out and then it just would really start stripping out. So I think the threads are kind of beat up on the end. I would have liked to have gotten that out and cleaned up that whole thing, but I'm not able to do so. So hopefully ultrasonic cleaner was able to get it good enough. But this is the goo that we're talking about. It's like applesauce. I found that when people use too much of the stable, and they kind of like dump it in afterwards, that's the outcome of it. It's stable, all right. Stable sludge. I'm going to put the intake manifold pull back on. I'm looking at, what is this crap? Maybe put some, it's not RTV, it's the harder of the two epoxies. I don't know if they felt they had an intake leak or whatever. But there's an O-ring that goes around there. So all that mess is pretty much unnecessary unless it's really bowed. I don't think so. We're just going to pop that O-ring out and flip it over so it kind of sits a little bit more proud. But I'm going to try taking it on a wire wheel and we'll knock off this crap. Alright, we got carb hooked up on the bottle. Let's get a little, some gas flow through. Squish that back into shape. Yeah, hopefully it doesn't come peeing out of the carb. And give that a second to fill. Hopefully you got enough battery to crank it over. Let's see what you get. Yeah, that does not look good. That ain't normal. After all that popping back, I decided to pop the valve cover off and see what we got going on. And that seems to be quite excessive valve adjustment there. And if you notice, it's missing the little keeper that goes on top of the valve on that one. So that one is missing altogether. I'm going to hoard. I think I have a cylinder head out in the back garage. I'm going to see if I have one in there and if it has one of those for it. So I went back in the stash. Remember the tractors that we did the engine swap on? And one of them had a blown motor, and I kind of kept all the bits and pieces for it. There's the starter, the carb, the coil, etc. A bunch of hardware that came with it, which is good because we need this bracket. And this was the cylinder head. Unfortunately, it was missing both of them. But deeper in the hoard, we went back further. And I knew I had another cylinder head laying around. And inside this one, I do see we have a keeper right there. Whether that's the right one or not, I'm not sure. It's got a different kind of lock underneath it. It's got that kind of lock underneath it. So, which one can we do? Hopefully that goes on there. Yeah, it does. Good. So let's go put that back together, adjust the valves on that, and then try it one more time. I think I have a blown head gasket though. Well, figure out where all that play was coming from. I went to go start cracking the valve loose to go adjust it. And you see the whole stud is turning. The whole thing backed out. So I would suspect somebody else was already in there though, because that keeper really wouldn't disappear. It would have been sitting in the bottom of the valve cover, not taking a walk like it did. So I'll go tighten that down. Almost close to what the valve adjustment should be. Yeah, I'll take that apart, tighten up the stud that it's on. And at least it explains where all that play was coming from. The push rod wasn't bent. Yeah, I don't see, that keeper's not under there. All right, I still think it has a blown head gasket. I couldn't tell if it was all popping out of the carb or was it popping some out of the side of the block. So we'll go give her a shot one more time. The valves are half-ass adjusted. Go to choke. Uh-oh. Come on. Give me one more. Trying to listen to it right now. So the motor sounds good. It doesn't sound like it's knocking at all on the bottom, which is the main concern after seeing all that gas kind of flush into there. Carb's a mess. It only run on the choke. You can see where we had no idle circuit and it was just trying to die. But I do have another carburetor behind me. And again, that's because we couldn't get that jet out of there. So I don't know. I may try another carb on it right now. I don't think it has a leaking head gasket. All that popping was just coming back out of the intake. I think it's just burning all the crap off of it. So I'm not sure what we're gonna do next, but we'll do something. That's the other carburetor. I just got done soaking it for 20 minutes. And then I was able to get the center out of that one. And you can see. Those holes get clogged. I could actually see it by eye that some of the little ones are clogged on this one. So that's what's the issue with the one that I couldn't get out. That gets all crudded up inside there, and you can get the main one clear. You can blow that one out through the top and through the center, but you can't get to those little ones on the side. So that's what we're gonna go achieve now. We'll put this one back together, put it in, and see how this one runs. Right, I've got the other carburetor on there. That one's a little older. Again, it does not have the shutoff switch on it, and what that can cause is that if you shut it off when it's full throttle, it can cause a backfire. Yeah, we should be all the way up at the choke. There we go. Now it'll idle, but it doesn't want to rev up. Just popping back like it's running too rich. Let's go out, bring her out. Let's see how the lawnmower works.
let that burn off for a little while.
So this is the bagger attachment that goes to the deck, the hose that goes to the deck. And it's got a split going right down here. Kind of, that's what I was pointing at. I got a hose clamp on it now, tying it together. We're trying to figure out like what's the best solution to do this. My first thought was to kind of like hit it with a soldering iron and glue it back together. But I think what I want to do is I'm going to put like a metal plate on it, curve it, to the roll of that, and maybe we'll drill through it from the inside or from the outside, and then on the inside we'll put rivets on the inside because it's the female end, so you want to rub on the sides. Oh, the jokes. Anyway, I think that one or that one. That'll go down further. Actually, probably too far. It's up in the handle. Where this one will go from side to side a little further. And the jokes keep writing themselves. I think we go with this one. We'll hammer that straight and we'll make a curve to it. Probably we could take the hose clamp. We'll just hose clamp this right on and drill it. What do you think? You agree? No? Yeah, see if we can get that sucker under there. Two tabs on a cider. Causing it to want to stay down a little further. I wonder if I should run this thing all the way up top. What do you think? Let's try it the way it is, we'll run it in. I gotta be fine. Let's see. You can go to the edge with it. Yeah, it should be good. We'll leave it like that, so as it gets beat up, you're not going to get cut by the metal if it wears down. All right, so I'm going to go drill. What's good for like 1, 2, 3, 4? We'll do that. Actually, we're doing each side of the crack first. The crack's here. We'll try to do 1, 2. I don't know. We'll do something. We say we try it, we see how it goes. Actually, that whole thing, if that's the split, we should probably put the metal direction to, huh? Did I go too far? That's where it's staying. Too bad. Yeah, let's go for one right there. That is one dull bit. But, well, that guy, nope, I was guessing at the bit size. Bit sucked anyway. Now will you fit? Yeah. All right, so we're gonna wanna go put that from the inside. And it should crimp down on that metal pretty good. I squeezed it before she was ready. Yeah. Let's try that again. That's pretty good. We'll hammer that down later. I say another one there. We'll branch it out and then we'll take that off and maybe do a couple more on top. So that's the after. I decided to try to stay. I thought about drilling two more here, but I want to try to introduce less amount of stuff to be able to crack right there. I think if I'm able to hammer that flat, the pressure's always going to be pushing out. It might be better off. I don't know. So now I was thinking about trying to knock down maybe a couple of those rivets on the other side. They still have the nub in the center of them, so they're only going to go so far, but maybe we'll give it a shot anyway. Yeah, that'd be better. You agree? miss it? Kind of thuddy sounded. That's what it is. Hey, you're Black with Nicholas Factory. And probably what caused the whole thing to begin with is this strap was broke. Where did that light? This strap was broke and it wasn't holding it together, so the pressure of it kind of just pinching like it is there. I finally made that so it'll crack. I don't have one of those, but you ever, you know, the black bungee cords and you end up breaking off one end. Yeah, that's why I hoard onto them. So we're going to try putting a slice, or drill a hole actually, up in here and put a hook on this end that can come over and grab it. So let's see how that works out for us. So I was thinking, instead of cutting that whole strap off of there, what if we were able to drill a hole in this one and just put an S-hook through it? Let's go try that first. Just don't know if the rubber's going to have enough meat on each side of it afterwards, you know what I mean? And we'll go something like... going in dry. Come on. And then we just hook that onto there. We can cut this crap off. Right. Don't need that. We don't need that. Probably got it choked up on a little bit more. Might bend that hook around a little bit so that this hook is smaller. We could probably close that whole this whole system up. And it'll snug it up a little bit and keep it so it doesn't want to come off as easy. What do you think? Yeah, let's go shrink those hooks up. Alright, let's see if we can. This one can close all the way because you don't want that one coming off at all. Correct? And that one just enough to get over that. Too bad it was a little bit more of a washer here. Too much? Ah, too much. And just enough to make it. Those slight adjustments that get you. There you go. I'm gonna go with that. We're going with that. Almost all set. Factory. Hey guys, so this is a couple days later. Sat the weekend came and did all the weekend kind of good stuff. And now it's back to trying to see if we can get this tractor finished up and off the bench. I think the last thing we did was the chute on the side. And we're gonna get into some other fine details. I think we're almost done with this one. The gas oil mix sat outside and I let it evaporate, so that's what's left of the oil. And I believe it was probably up to about right there, probably triple that when the gas and oil was mixed inside there. I'm gonna go dump that out. Let's get started back on the tractor, get it finished up. So I think you know, other than sharpening the blades and kind of doing a function check a little bit more on it, there's not much left. That plug wire on the end of it looks kind of beat. I figured we'd knock the rust off, and the other bag had a new plug boot. See if we can clean that up and Looks like it's on there pretty good. At the inside of it, doesn't look like there's much rust on the nipple. See if we could feed that guy. Nah. I'm gonna put some dielectric grease on the inside of that and then use that for the slimy mugu. Get that up on there. Gotta goober it up. Let's see if that'll work. Amen. Plus it'll help keep it from corroding in the future. You think you got it far enough yet? Now I do. Let's see if we go with that. So I can put the hood back on, put the headlights on, and I got to take a peek at the mower deck. The bearing sounded quiet. I do want to hit the front fittings with the grease fitting. Should be one there and then one in on the spindle. Some do, some don't. And then we'll take a peek at the mower deck and take care of that. So, put the hood back on. I want to put the headlight assembly on, but it just keeps falling out. And the little tabs don't grab on anything. I have a feeling they're just kind of bent down that way a little too far. So I figure maybe we'll try a little bit of heat. Not that much. Let's see if I can affect the melt the headlight. I'd be better off with a heat gun, maybe. Yeah, it's going the wrong way. There it goes. That's warm. Try the other one. Go see how that does. One's good. One snaps in now. This one still doesn't. Woohoo, that's warm on the fingers, let's just say. Alright. Alright, let's see if that's any better. That one. We're gonna go with that. I'm not gonna mess with it anymore. Before it would just fall right out if I went to go do anything. So we'll run it around the yard a little bit and hit a couple of sippy holes and see if it falls out. And it's not a 14 horse, it's a 17. I think we should get rid of the incriminating evidence. And now it's time for a little mower blade access. I think the bagger liked it. Our blade situation is, so I am looking at this point right here. I'm gonna rotate that blade, make sure it's kind of ending up in the same spot. I know they're not bent. I'm gonna look at that other one. I'm just gonna go pick a point on that wall over there. And that one's bent. You can see the distance between there and there. There's about an inch difference between the two of them. I'm gonna go back in my hoard and go steal us a blade. Let me just take a double look and make sure the edges aren't beat up. That one looks pretty good.
it's fine. We'll sharpen it, but so that guy is no good. I'm gonna change that one out. The thing I wanted to show was, so here's the blade that we know is good. And you can see this is the one that's out. And I also just like to spin them, make sure they line up to each other, because the mounting, you see how those two are good. They're pretty close to each other. And I spin this one. The heights of them are still the same. So just make sure that the deck itself, the mandrel or the spindle is not kicked on an angle is what I'm looking for. So I think they're pretty level going across, and that's not an issue. Sometimes they get rusty too and they start flexing. The mower deck itself starts turning. So there's that blade. I got it out from there. You can see this is the side that is doing okay, and this is the side where it dips down and where the bend is. The blades are actually in nice shape. Generally when you see wear, they'll start to cut a groove right into it right here, and eventually this whole back corner will break off. This is the lift that the mower deck has. It causes the vacuum to come underneath it. And of course the front edge gets beat up too, but those are definitely easy to grind that back. But we're gonna go try bending that bend out of there and see if we can get it to lay straight again. It should go. All right, so we want this guy that way. See, need some more. Sometimes you gotta shock it with a hammer, so you need to be a really good hit. I think it took quite a bit to bend it that way in the first place. And I see that's probably 80% of it. We're just gonna give her a little more. That's looking pretty good. I'm gonna go sharpen it, we'll put it back on, and we'll see how it looks when we spin it. And after the bend, this is the side, you see where I marked it, is I pretty much go by within a quarter inch if you get them. Here's the other side. So, that's fine. You just don't want it so that when you're cutting the grass, it's leaving a, you know, 3/4 of an inch taller on one side than the other. That, you won't even recognize that. So I just need to go sharpen this blade still, but this one's already been done. Most of your sharpening is on this side, and then you just kiss the back side of it for any metal that gets, you know, pushed under, but all the sharpening is done on the one edge. And all the work is done, actually all the work is really done here, but you just need to sharpen about that far. And it's not like you need a razor's edge on it. Even when they're new, they don't come that sharp. It's almost got a flat face on it for just a very little bit. But that is the, you put a sharp edge on it, the sharp edge is gone within the first 15 minutes of you cutting it. So it just doesn't last that long. That's it, guys. I think I'm gonna wrap it up, other than to kind of clean it up on it. So the bagger assembly seems like it's doing quite well. Should be good for fall cleanup of leaves. And the other thing I noticed is that when you shut it off, you go to idle, it smokes some when you do that. So we're gonna cycle it a couple times, see if that goes away or not. If not, I might have to look into that. But I'm probably gonna go shut this video down at the end of this one, and we'll call it quits, and we'll get on to something else. So with that, I wanna thank all you guys for hanging out in the garage with me and doing some wrenching. And we'll see you on the next video. Later. Got a blown head gasket. It's pressurizing the crankcase and pushing it up to the breather, and then the breather's sucking the oil, and that's what's causing it to do that at an idle. Not done yet.